Hello, I'm Pietro Foti and I'm a PhD candidate at the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. With this presentation, I will show you some findings regarding the mechanical properties of Scots spine based on numerical modeling and experiments. These works are beneficial and aligned with the sample project. The presentation is composed of two different studies performed on Scots spine exposed to different climate conditions during their lifetime. In the first section of each study, I will introduce the aim of the work, then I will show you in detail the samples analyzed and the numerical simulations considered. After this, we will go through the main results of each work and the conclusions that it is possible to draw out. The aim of the first study is to provide a proposal to standardize the investigation of the fracture toughness of woods. Such a need is evident going through the available literature that deals with such a topic. In this slide, you can see an overview of different geometry used to determine the fracture toughness of woods. The problem is, however, not limited to the use of different geometries for the tested woods. The mechanical properties of this material are indeed influenced also by the material orientation, being wood an orthotropic material, or by pre-experimental conditioning. As already mentioned, the mechanical properties of woods are highly influenced by the pre-experimental conditioning. The Scots spine specimens tested for this study were obtained from a Scots spine beam kept outdoor for 18 months in the harsh and humid climate of Trondheim, whose temperature and relative humidity range are highlighted in the slide. Subsequently, the beam was brought inside and kept in the NTNU workshop for 4 months. After this period, the beam was cut into 25 slices with a 2 cm thickness. From each slice, 4 specimens have been realized. However, the new indoor environmental conditions resulted in the generation of micro and macro cracks within the beam, leading to the extrusion of some slices at different locations along the longitudinal direction of the beam. CT specimens have been realized according to the standard reported in the slide. However, due to the longer length in the radial direction, according to the coordinate system provided in this slide and consistent with that commonly used for woods, the specimens could also be considered double cantilever beam ones. 49 specimens were tested using a universal testing machine at the displacement rate of 0.5 mm per minute, recording the load displacement curve. Each test have been also recorded through a digital camera synchronized with the testing machine in order to relate the crack lengths with the critical points in the load time curve. It is worth to highlight that not all the specimens have been considered due to the deviation of cracks along the tangential direction during the experiments. For the purpose of this study, a finite element model has been created with the Abacus software. The element used was a second-order element, while the discretization in the model has been determined in order to have a higher mesh density at the crack tip to improve the accuracy of the model, optimizing the computational time. Different numerical simulations have been performed with changing the crack length, marked in red in the model, in order to determine the stress intensity factor corresponding to an applied load of 1 Newton with different geometrical configurations. Having such a parameter, the fracture toughness can be evaluated by simply multiplying the normalized stress intensity factor for the applied load. The fracture toughness has been also evaluated through a modified equation on the basis of that provided in the standard, whose application complies with the plane strain condition determined by the standard on the basis of the geometrical dimensions of the specimen and the 0.2% offset yield strength in tension. The values of the fracture toughness evaluated by means of the modified equation are in good agreement with those obtained through the experiments, as it is possible to see from the diagram. In this slide, the fracture toughness trend with increasing the crack length in the CT specimen is reported. It is worth noting that a trend along the longitudinal direction has been detected for the fracture toughness of the tangential radial plane. The moisture content inside the Scott pine beam has been also evaluated both in radial and longitudinal direction, starting from the values of temperature and relative humidity according to the procedure reported in this slide. It is worth underlining the longer time required by the moisture content to reach an equilibrium condition, with respect to the thermal equilibrium in the material. A relative humidity gradient is present both in radial and longitudinal direction, as it is possible to see from the figure. Finally, the determining fracture toughness values in this study, together with their moisture content, have been compared with other works in literature, having similar moisture content ranges. The data are in good agreement with some of the work reported, but it is worth noting there are discrepancies that is possible to find investigating such a parameter. These differences have to be addressed to various factors, such as pre-experimental conditioning of the wood, the sample geometry, the orientation of the crack, and so on. This makes clear the need of a standardized procedure for this kind of investigations. We will now see the work done about the study B. The main aim of this work was to prove, through a non-destructive technique, that undamaged samples are more prone to damage than damaged samples exposed to similar climate conditions. Although yet to be proven experimentally, this hypothesis, known as Mikulski postulation, is especially important in the cultural heritage field, considering that cultural relevant objects have mostly undergone significant relative humidity changes during their life. With this regard, the definition of a threshold value, in terms of relative humidity value, or in terms of a parameter that is possible to relate to this last one, is beneficial for a proper determination of maintenance or conservation scenarios. As for the other study, the pre-experimental conditioning represents a parameter that cannot be neglected. The material considered in this study has been acclimatized in a climate chamber for 18 days, at a relative humidity of 80%. After this first period, the specimens were removed from the chamber and treated with three different surface treatments. This has been done to force the water desorption through the lateral surfaces of the slices, in the subsequent step in the climate chamber, in which the three slices have been subjected to a severe drop of relative humidity to 30% and kept constant for the next 21 days. Such a pre-experimental conditioning resulted in microcracks for two of the three slices considered in the present study. CT specimens have been realized according to the standard reported in this slide. 8 specimens were tested using a universal testing machine at the specimen rate of 1.5 mm per minute, recording the load specimen curve. Each test has been also recorded through a digital camera synchronized with the testing machine in order to relate the crack length with the critical points in the load time curve, while the acoustic emission in the specimens has been monitored by two different acoustic emission sensors at the same time. A similar finite element model has been used to investigate the fracture properties of this component, as it is possible to see from this slide. Similarly to the other study in this presentation, the fracture toughness has been evaluated through a modified equation obtained from the one reported in the standard. The difference is in the establishment of a new normalized crack progression parameter, reported in the diagram on the top. The predictor fracture toughness has been found in good accordance with the experimental values. Indeed, the modified equation yielded a mean error of 3.12 in percentage, while the correlation used by the standard has a mean error of almost 25%. The three techniques used in this study allowed to determine the energy released by the fracture over the fractured area, defined as dynamic surface energy. The dynamic surface energy has been evaluated both during the load decrease and increase portions of the load displacement curve, that corresponds to brittle and ductile behavior. It has been observed that the values of the dynamic surface energy differ vastly between load increase and decrease. The dynamic surface energy in the low decrease portion has a higher value in those specimens obtained from sliced fractured in the clemate chamber. A threshold value for the dynamic surface energy has been found. Above this value, there are the specimens obtained from fractured slices in the clemate chamber. In conclusion, the study A showed how the use of a modified relation can lead to an higher accuracy in determining the fracture toughness of wood samples, while the comparison of the results with other studies in literature highlighted the need of a standardized procedure for this kind of investigations. The study B further proved how a modified relation is able to improve the fracture toughness determination, overcoming problems related to various lengths of the specimens, while the analysis performed on the acoustic emission energy and the value of the dynamic surface energy showed how already damaged samples are less prone to further damages than undamaged ones. Thank you for your kind attention.